Jason Kavinsky that night when he was shot, who reported later that he heard Vincent screaming, "Is not anybody going to cut on my belly?" Doesn't sound like someone who wanted to commit suicide. Okay, but nobody helped him. The Marguerite Gachet doing it, I think they were involved, and I'll show you why. Jacques Levert was the carpenter who made all of Vincent's frame, and he also made Vincent's coffin. And then, of course, you've got the butler and the gardener.
Yes.
And then you've got even his brother who paid for everything for years. So you have to figure out who done it. So was it the two brothers from Paris? Or were they just patsies? They kind of fit the narrative now. But did they do it? Could they do it? So now there's a lot of testimony on both sides of this. And just like in a court case, you have to figure out who's the most credible. You have the doctor, you have the doctor's son, and you have the daughter of the innkeeper. So the doctor and the son are highest on the list of people of interest. And that story that's been around for over 100 years was pretty widely accepted. Most everybody here probably still has heard that, that Vincent committed suicide, his nuts cut off his ear, and shot himself. And we're trying to change that perspective. That got started when Adeline LaRue, came forward in the 1950s. When in the 1930s, Irving Stone wrote a book called Lust for Life. MGM bought the rights to that, and then there was the war, and they didn't do much with it. After the war, and Vincent's fame kept growing, they decided to do this movie, Lust for Life, based on the book. And it was a big deal. MGM was spending huge amounts of money, relatively. France was decimated from World War II. They were into their fifth government, and the economy was really terrible. So MGM was quite a life support system at the time. And so MGM put articles or ads in the newspapers throughout France. Anybody that knew Vincent Van Gogh, please come forward, tell us your story. Adeline had heard stuff on the French radio about how Vincent died from the Gachet, and she knew it wasn't correct. So she came forward, and it's interesting because when she came forward, there are three portraits of Adeline wearing the same dress, all done on the same day. Okay. Until she came forward, they did not know that this, who this was. The portraits were called by the art historians at the time, the Lady in Blue.
Okay.
All three of them. And so she came forward, and now they're named Adeline LaRue. But what she did was she really told the story different than what the normal expected story had been, and that the Gachets were probably not telling the truth. Okay. So they gave their story, the doctor and his son. They're really the persons of interest. Now, this is a very famous portrait, and the reason I'm talking about it is Dr. Gachet. This portrait set a record in 1990. It sold for $84.25 million, something like that. It was the highest price paid for a piece of art up until that point. It was bought by a Japanese industrialist billionaire. Okay. He recently died. Nobody knows where this famous painting is. All we have are digital images. Okay. Now, the story really gets sad because this guy was a little cuckoo, and he put the painting, allegedly, in his casket to be with him. And then he incinerated the casket.
It's a cob.
Why?
Yeah.
So that's why I'm giving you a little extra remember Paul Jr. and his father both thought they were artists. They were very ecstatic to have Vincent there in the beginning, but they got very jealous of Vincent because Vincent could knock off a painting in an hour or two, and they couldn't, you know, be able to copy it. So the son, in 1904, painting under the name of Louis von Meisel, made this painting. And he entitled it, The Place Where Van Gogh Committed Suicide. A little strange. First of all, it's not a wheat field like everybody would think.
Right.
Okay. Keep iron. And this is a wall on the Rue Boucher. So how did he know this is where Van Gogh committed suicide, unless he was there? This is almost 15 years later. It's just sort of like, I need to get this out and tell the truth, or, you know, confess or something. I don't know. But it's kind of suspicious. And here he is, years later, at the gravesite. And I said, visiting the graves of both brothers many years after the murders. And that's Pearl.
Yes.
And that's another story. So, now, we can go to just question and answers, or I can give you the nitty-gritty on the love story, finally love.
I want to hear the love story, because that obviously would play into...
Well,
there's no motive that you have identified yet.
Well, yeah.
But...
Well, the Gachets...
Yeah.
An important side thing, I don't really think I covered it, but when Vincent was dead and buried, and they went and actually put him in his grave, the father and son came back to the Louvain, stripped the wall of all the Van Gogh paintings, took them away in a cart, okay? And there were 26 of them, and we know that because that's what they ended up donating to the Louvre many years later. What they did is they took these paintings that nobody knew existed, and before Vincent really got famous,
okay.
And they started copying them. And they made copies, and they sold them, okay? They sold the Van Goghs,
sure,
in Germany and all over, mostly in Germany. And when they did donate this stuff to the Louvre, it took the experts years to figure out which were the fakes. Okay? So there was a motive there, and you have to understand that Dr. Gachet was an art collector. He had art from Monet and Manet and Renoir and Cézanne. He knew what he was doing. And so when Vincent died, taking the 26 paintings alone would be a really good explanation for his motive. But that wasn't the trigger.
I don't think he exploited the circumstances.
Exactly. He took advantage of the situation.
Right. That's not necessarily a motive to actually commit the murder.
Exactly. So now why do you think he did it then?
Hiding something.
But
there's another reason for taking the paintings.
Well, now I'm going to tell you the real why.
Okay.
Ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Vincent Lovers. Told this is the love triangle.
Yeah. Vincent told the policeman, I did it to myself. Don't blame another. Okay. So we don't even know if that's actually true. It's sort of the story that was passed down, but there's no solid evidence that he actually said that. It's all secondhand. But if it's true, why would Vincent accept full responsibility for his mortal wound? Why would he say he did it? Why would he shoot himself in the belly? All right. So, if it was an accident, would Vincent likely protect these two teenagers? Not as likely. But if it was an honor killing, and Vincent